Hachette Audio presents You've Been Played, How Corporations, Governments, and Schools Use Games to Control Us All. Written by Adrian Hon, read by Damian Lynch. Introduction. A warehouse worker picks a book from a tray and her virtual dragon speeds up on a screen beside her. If she works faster and longer than her colleagues, she'll win the race and get an award. It's a distraction from the tedium, but it's hardly fun. Not far away, an exhausted Uber driver is about to sign off when a new quest pops up on his app. If he completes another 3 trips, he'll get a $6 bonus. He's barely making enough to cover the payments on his car, so he sighs and accepts. At home, his partner obsessively researches the dangerous QAnon conspiracy theory on obscure forums, videos, and blogs. It's not as relaxing as watching TV, but uncovering clues and drawing connections makes him feel like he's playing an exclusive game. Next door, a retiree buys a subscription to a brain training game. It tells her that if she plays its scientific mini-games every day, she'll get smarter and avoid dementia. The game doesn't tell her that going for a walk outside would be just as helpful. I've spent the last decade making one of the most popular gamified apps in the world, so you'd expect me to be the first person to spread the gospel of gamification. Yet today, nothing makes me more worried. Gamification should be a delight. We all choose to play video games and board games and jigsaw puzzles and sports in our spare time. Who wouldn't want to use ideas from game design to make difficult or dull activities more fun, to gamify them? That's what led me to co-create Zombies Run, a game that's turned running into an adventure for over 10 million players. It's why I admire Rock Band, Kerbal Space Program, and Pokemon Go for making it enjoyable to learn the guitar, understand orbital mechanics, and walk more every day. But these apps and games aren't the gamification we're most likely to encounter in our lives. Our phones and watches now come with built-in missions and achievements for hitting ever-increasing fitness and productivity goals. In the classroom, teachers reward and punish children with behavioral management apps, doling out points at the tap of a button. Everyone from Uber drivers and call center agents to programmers and investment bankers is having their work subjected to gamification, the latest friendly face on labor practices that exploit millions. And with gamification spreading to social networks, trading apps, credit scores, conspiracy theories, and social credit systems, our world feels increasingly like a game we can't stop playing, where the stakes are so high, failure isn't met with a cheery try again, but the loss of your livelihood, and worse. It's bad enough that gamification has become the 21st century's most advanced form of behavioral control, but there's even worse news. It's also deadly boring. It turns out that wrapping a veneer of missions and points and challenges around the job of a warehouse worker doesn't change its crushing repetitiveness, though Amazon continues to try. Over the years, I've found little evidence that most gamification actually works or anyone finds it fun, and so I assumed that it would eventually be abandoned or rejected. But since its beginnings in the early 2000s, when apps like Foursquare, Nike, and Strava introduced badges and levels to encourage people to exercise more and share their favorite shops and restaurants, gamification has only grown and grown. Practically anything that can be monitored and recorded has been gamified. And as technology has become cheaper, smaller, and ever more powerful, colonizing our homes, our workplaces, and even our bodies, so too have the opportunities for gamification expanded to occupy every part of our lives. Sometimes gamification really is fun. You can only smile at a game like Chore Wars that turns vacuuming the carpet and washing the dishes into quests for your family. More often, gamification is used to manipulate and control. Whether that's unscientific brain training games promising to make you smarter, or propaganda games spreading dangerous misinformation online, or video games tricking players into spending thousands of dollars on in-game items they can't afford. For these games, helping you is far down their list of priorities. That's why I'm writing this book. With today's gamification, you're no longer the player, you're being played. I became a game designer by an unusual route. Like all my friends, I loved playing video games growing up in the 1980s and 90s, and secretly hoped I might one day make games for a living. When it came to deciding what to study at university, however, I took what I thought was a more sensible option: experimental psychology and neuroscience at Cambridge University. I found my studies fascinating, but video games never lost their attraction. Whenever I wasn't writing code to analyze brain activity or researching synesthesia, I wrote about something even more fascinating to me: the burgeoning genre of alternate reality games, ARGs, which combine the real world and the internet. Not long after I began a PhD in neuroscience at Oxford University, I left to become director of play for one of the world's biggest ARGs, Perplex City. A few years later, I co-founded Six to Start in 2007 with my brother Dan Hon, where I designed games for the BBC, Penguin Books, Walt Disney Imagineering, the British Museum, Microsoft, and Death Cab for Cutie. Six to Start has a long background in making serious games that attempt to not only entertain, but to educate and edify. Games that have won plenty of awards, including Best of Show and Best Game at South by Southwest. However, we're most widely known for our gamification of running in Zombies Run, a smartphone game which launched in 2012. Featured by Apple and Google and played by over 10 million people, the enormous success of Zombies Run led to a whole series of fitness games, including The Walk and Superhero Workout, many of which were co-created with the award-winning novelist Naomi Alderman. Most recently, we've worked with the NHS and researchers at University College London, UCL, on the gamification of fitness in the real world and in virtual reality. I've spent the past two decades on two related tasks: understanding how humans think and making games that try to improve our lives. My games are routinely showcased as being the best examples of gamification in the world, so be assured. This book isn't by an outsider who doesn't understand technology and thinks video games are the devil's work. Nor is it by someone who believes technology and video games will save humanity. It's by someone who wants to explain what gamification really is, what it could be at its best, and how it's being used to manipulate us against our will. It's tempting to classify everything with points and pixels as gamification, especially with video games ascendant in popular culture. I share the definition used by most designers and critics, where gamification means the use of game design principles for non-game purposes. Those principles include some concepts that long predate video games and board games, like points, badges, challenges, levels, and leaderboards, along with concepts that are much newer, like compulsion loops and AI-driven non-player characters, NPCs. As for those non-game purposes, pick any human need or endeavor you can imagine: education, health, science, politics, companionship, terror, and of course, material gain. This means there's no bright line for what counts as gamification. It's more of a family resemblance, encompassing everything from SimCity and Peloton to frequent flyer programs and Chinese social credit systems. It also means that one can find examples of gamification going back decades and even centuries, long before the term gained wide usage in the first decade of the 2000s. This book covers some of those older examples, but for the purposes of brevity, it is not an exhaustive record of all of gamification or its history. Instead, I explore these historical antecedents as a way of understanding today's gamification and how it might evolve. In Chapter 1, I begin by tracing out the technological and social factors that led to the rise of gamification in the 21st century. The spread of the internet and the adoption of easy-to-use, real-time Web 2.0 technologies made it easy to add generic game-like features to apps and websites to boost engagement, i.e. users spending more time viewing websites and contributing valuable information for free. The simultaneous rise of gaming culture and technological optimism in the early 2010s led to the belief that video games, once a maligned hobby, were in fact an unalloyed good.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.